some turtles. We hinge just in the front, and we hinge in both front and back. So, Plastron will have some crates to help. Yeah.
Isn't there a special characteristic, like a type of pistol, platform of bills and wheels on the platform?
Oh, there is. There is in terms of a depression, and I'll talk about that.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so let's just mainly the class is going to be learning the names of the animals and identifying. Again, most of your tests will be there. But I will tell you a little bit about each one. So snapping turtles are in the Chelidridae. They are ones that has a reduced plastron. I should have shown you that. But you flip them over, they really don't have much of an under shell. And that means they can't close up. But they don't really need to get that protection because they're mean as can be. You know, they've got a pretty good beak and they can bite. So, as the name kind of implies, they're pretty aggressive. So they don't, and they also live in the bottom of rivers and ponds where they, again, aren't going to run into predators that much. So you see them cross the road when they're coming out to lay eggs or something like that. The two species of snapping turtle are not real easy to tell apart. I know a lot of professional herpetologists get it wrong because they'll see one, they'll see a turtle that has that had these little ridges on it, and they'll think, oh, that's an alligator snapping turtle. Well, although this one seems pretty smooth, young ones can have some pretty good ridges on it. What you want to look for are the scutes along the side. The alligator snapping turtle has two rows of scutes, whereas the common snapper don't really have one. So do you see the second? I think you will. Yeah, I think it's the second. Do you see these extra scutes here?
Mm-hmm.
So it's got one row down here, and then it's got a second row.
And that's
got,
the alligator?
That's the alligator. They get really big. They're hunted. They're not allowed to. Not allowed to hunt in East in Texas. They're protected. They're very rare. Yeah.
What
does
the reduced plastron do? It doesn't allow to close.
They can't close up. They can't hide their head inside the shell, so they don't bother. It's just now they'll pull it back a little bit, but it's not going to give them very much protection. Or their legs either. They can't pull their legs. So that's how you. That's the best way to tell the two apart. Now they kind of look different, but it's a little dangerous not to look at that. The Malacoplemmies, or Macroplemmies, is the alligator snap. They get very large, 150 pounds. I remember seeing one that got picked up here in East Texas. It was in the back of a small truck, and it filled the whole thing. They get quite large. They definitely don't come out very much. They stay in the bottom of a pond or usually rivers, bigger rivers, and they're ambush predators. They just sit there in the bottom with their mouth open, and they have their tongue is pink. It looks like a little worm, and they wiggle it, and then a fish swims by to bite the worm. Rabbit, and that's
the
type of mimicry.
Huh? Two questions actually. Do they both have the long tail like that? Like the
Yeah.
Okay, how long can they stay in the water?
They stay under a long time. I don't know for sure, but definitely 20 minutes or so. Now, turtles actually in the wintertime, when more oxygen in the water can actually breathe underwater through their cloaca. They've got blood vessels in the cloaca and they can actually absorb some oxygen that way. But that's during hibernation in the mud. when they're warm, they've got to come up to breathe, but the nose, I don't know if you can see, it's the nostrils, or you know, they can kind of get a breath there without having to come to the surface. The next family are some little guys. I guess I should give you the order, right? Is it on your order here? Testudines. Yeah. All right. So the next family are the kind of sternidae. These guys are much smaller, but they're aquatic too, and rarely come out. Well, they'll bask occasionally on logs, but not a lot. They tend to hang around at the bottom. We actually have these on campus. Not a huge number, but we've got some traps out today. So at the end of the class today, we're going to go down and see if we can catch some turtles. Probably about 4 o'clock or so we'll go down. But they'll give you an opportunity to try it out your iNaturalist. You should be able to get a couple of your requirements done there. The Eastern musk turtle is, I find those on campus. Sphenothrus odoratus, Mississippi mud. The way you tell those two apart, well, there's a couple things. You can see the little white stripes on the face of the Eastern musk turtle. The mud turtle doesn't have it. The main thing is if you flip them over, the mud turtle is going to have a plastron that will completely cover it up. It's kind of like a box turtle. It can seal up and pull its legs in. Whereas the sternothrus don't do that. Now, the razorback musk turtle has a kind of a keel, like on its back. So it's where the name razorback comes from. But another way to tell it from the odoratus, this is an odoratus. There are in the razorback, in carinatus, these hinge areas have a lot of flesh showing, much more flesh than the other. That's how you can tell them apart. Carinatus refers to a carina, like in the birds. So that's why it's called a razorback. These guys eat worms and pretty carnivorous. They eat things off the bottom of the ponds. So you'll see them at night if you happen to shine a flashlight here on campus along the water's edge. You can sometimes see them walking on the bottom looking for a worm or something.
Wait, are those two the same? The top right one and the other razorbacks? Are those two the same?
This one goes here. That one up there is this one.
And you said this one has a full plastron.
This guy does, yeah. In your book, in your field guide, the Peterson's field guide, the green one that you have, if you look, it shows those pictures of those on the bottom. The next family is a big one. But I've only put out a few. We've got several of these actually, some other species here, but these three are pretty easy to tell apart. And then we've got the three-toed box turtle. So the red-eared slider, Trachomys scripta, is found all over the world now, but it is a North American turtle. It's used for, it's shipped around to China and places for food. Kept as pets, people releasing. They're all over Europe. Every country in the world has red-eared sliders in their ponds. They do really well. They'll eat lots of different things, so they just do really well.
If they're all over the world, are they invasive or are they more?
Invasive typically implies that it's a problem. problem. I don't know that these are necessarily a problem, but they're definitely alien. Okay?
Yeah.
Alien species. They're easy to identify when they're live. We'll see some down here on campus. They all have the red blotch on the side of the head. It's not an ear, all that. In alcohol, it turns white. So be careful with the specimens in the lab. You'll see a big white patch there, and that'll tell you it's the radiator slide. You can also kind of look at the bellies. There's some patterns on the bellies that differ too.
Hey, Mark Ford. I'm not far for interviews, but on the list, this is the map turtle, has a species name to it, geographic, and all that slide has this code.
This one's, I think that, well, I better check and see which one's correct. Yeah. I'll have to double check for sure and see what's current, but I'm thinking Pseudo Geographic is right, and I didn't change this. So again, go with your handout. It's called Pseudo Geographica. Coni used to be just a subspecies. Because it had the shell has like a map, looks like a map, on it, lots of little squiggles and stuff. So, like a topographic map, so that's where the name comes from. And again, that's why they call them Mississippi maps, because it looks like a shell has maps on it. So that'll help you. They also have a yellow crescent behind the eye. It just doesn't show very well right there. She'll be able to see it in the lab. River cooters, we have those on campus too. We don't have map turtles on campus. They tend to be more of a river species. They eat like snails when they're little, when they're small, and the big females will eat mussels. Turtles, the females tend to get bigger than the males. It has a lot to do with, you're going to lay eggs. They lay a lot of eggs. The bigger you are, the better. Yeah?
What?
Yeah, it's got just a yellow crescent. You'll see it in the lab. Instead of the patch that we saw with the other one, this will be a more crescent shape. You'll probably have to look for several characters on it to tell it from the other. And the same thing with river cooter. Concina is, when they're little, they look one way, and when they get bigger, a lot of the pattern fades out. But it doesn't have any markings on the head, any of the big patches. So that'll be the key for it.
No patches?
No markings on it, no big patches or marks. I mentioned the map turtle is kind of a specialist on mussels and snails. The other two are pretty generalists. In fact, river cooters will eat algae and stuff like that, but they'll eat fish, dead stuff if they can find a dead fish. So they will eat other things. They will eat. Do you have questions? No. Well, it's going to look white. Won't look yellow anymore, yeah. The three-toed box turtle is a terrestrial one. Terrapini carolina. It's got, some pattern to it, big shell, and the name implies both the front and the back have hinges, so it can close up. They can pull its head in completely, its feet in completely, and get protected. These guys can too, but this just happens to be a little remote. Definitely very good at it. Like if a dog tries to open it up, they're pretty strong. They get damaged, but they don't, they can withstand an attack like that. The three-toed box turtles, as Robert mentioned, they have a depression. The males have a depression in their plastron, and they mate with the female. They basically they'll bang their shells together. When the female's ready to mate, the male will hook his claws in her under her shell, and she'll close up on him. So he's copulating. His toenails are in there, so it doesn't close up completely. It might not feel too good.
Difference for your fingers.
Yeah. He sticks his claws in there, and he'll lay on the female with that. So the way you can tell the males and the females apart is the male will have a depression in the plastron. Now, a live one, the males, box turtles have red eyes, females have yellow eyes, and the male will have some additional red. This is a female. They'll have some red on the legs, but again, fades in alcohol. But if we find any live ones on our field trip, you'll get to be able to see the color. Now these guys court too, but I think you remember from the lecture that the males have long fingernails, now their claws are not. They have long claws in the front, and they use them to signal the female the way in front of her face. So that's how they
also or just the claw?
They all of these three. Now these guys don't. No, these three have long claws on in the males.
You said females will have red eyes, females will have yellow eyes?
Yeah, these have, females have yellow eyes, and these have red eyes. The next family, the Triuncidae, pallid, spiny, soft shell, name relates to the fact that their shell is kind of leathery-like rather than hard like we've been seeing. They hide in the bottom of muddy streams and rivers, and they basically have a very long neck. They can stick it up. They have a long nose, so they can stick their nose up and get air. They don't have to come out of the mud. You see them pretty close to the edge of a river in mud, but usually you'll spook them and they'll dash out to deep water. So they get protected by going out. Quick swimmers, they have web feet for swimming, and so they can get away pretty easily. The name Spinifera refers to the fact that if you rub your hands along the back here, you kind of feel some little spines. There's a smooth one too, which supposedly occurs here, but I've never found it. So the pallid spiny soft shell is the only one. Apollona spinifera.
Those spines were only on the back part of the shell?
Yeah, you just feel it. Yeah, you'll be able to tell. The geckos. We didn't have any geckos in East Texas. The native geckos, banded geckos down in Southwest Texas. But we had one alien species that got into Texas on shipments from the Mediterranean, from Europe, and got released in Galveston. They come in on boxes of fruit and stuff like that. And they managed to move their way up. And now they're way up in the United States. They normally come from around the Mediterranean Sea in Europe and some of the Arabian countries. They're a small gecko. We have them here on campus. Occasionally you'll see the babies run around in the hallway. The females will lay their eggs. They can lay their eggs. They stick them on the wall and inside the ceiling here, places like that. So they're pretty pretty tolerant of really dry conditions. Most reptile lakes need a little bit of moisture. These guys don't. The other thing is that the females can store sperm, so they can have several clutches of eggs. Geckos are weird in that every gecko in the world only lays two eggs at a time. They never evolved the option of having more. So all they can do is lay multiple clutches quickly. And these guys are pretty good at that. So the female might will mate one time. She may be able to lay six or eight clutches without a male. So again, that probably helped in their ability to invade a new area. Because all you'd have to have is one female. She could lay a number of clutches in different places. They're kind of transparent almost. Definitely very light colored. They have the toes. They're not sticky or anything, but they have the ability to attach to the wall and crawl on a completely smooth surface. It's kind of an interesting phenomenon of how the little cells will hold on the toes. They only lay two eggs at a time.
That's called a clutch.
Yeah, a clutch, yeah. So the clutch size is two. In every species of gecko, remember there are, a couple thousand different species.
And this one just does it really fast?
Well, maybe not all of them, but these guys
right.
can do it pretty quick. They can grow up pretty fast. I don't know exactly how long it is between, but it's probably only a few weeks. But it's Hemidactylus persicus.
Dr. Ford?
Yeah.
One of those geckos were those, I don't think you said those were, if they're the other species, were those geckos or are they just were the geckos, I think the last time I had this class, was said the geckos were the geckos.
Again, yeah, they're just alien species. I don't think they compete necessarily because they're pretty mutualistic with humans. The only place you find them are around cities where gardeners have moved into that country. Anolis carolinensis is the northern green anole. Pretty common. You'll see them around apartments. They're called polycrotidae, which refers to their ability to have change from brown to green. When they're brown when they're cold or stressed out, green when they're happy. The males have bigger dewlaps. The dewlap is that the name for that throat patch, throat fan. Not sure where that name came from. So the males will bounce up and down and that throat fan will come out. There's a pattern that is both species specific. It lets other green anoles know that, you know, I'm a green anole. If there are other species like brown anoles around or some of the others. But it also signals females that I'm a good male. So there's some sexual selection involved. Males are pretty territorial. They'll chase other ones away, that kind of thing. They, like I said, you'll find them around homes. They've kind of expanded their range because people water their yards and they do well when they're in moist environments. Phrynosomatidae are the horned lizards and the fence lizards. They have kind of rough scales. The scales, if you run your hand backwards up, you'll see they're pretty sharp, pretty rough. Definitely obvious in the horned lizard, but you can see it in the fence lizards too. Horned lizards are pretty well gone from the Tyler area. I haven't seen any in years. they eat ants, and we've sprayed for most of our leaf cutter ants. That's the species that they eat. And they're gone. The ants are gone, so the lizards are gone. So they're threatened in the state. It's pretty rare in East Texas. And in fact, the eastern fence lizard seems to decline too. I don't see them anymore at all. Even just 5 years ago, I used to see them. They're called fence lizards because you'll see them on the side of a fence post. They tend to get up there to warm up. They have long toes. They're pretty fast. Males have some color under their chin and on the side of the body. So they bob. They don't have a dewlap. They will bob up and down. And when they do, they kind of turn their body a little bit so that the blue shows to the other male. So, again, different species of fence lizard will have different colors under the body. The skinks, on the other hand, tend to use pheromones, some. There are some glands in different lizards. Actually, we had glands in some of the turtles, too. The musk turtle, as you might imagine, had glands that may be used in communication. We're not sure. But on the lizards, we definitely know that they use the chemicals for communication. The skinks are ground dwellers, and it makes sense if you're on the ground all the time to mark your territory. It's an easy way to send signals. We have several species in East Texas, but these two are the only really abundant ones. Little brown skink is called now. Skincella lateralis is extremely common. Every little garden that somebody has will have these in them. They're an important animal because they're the prey for a lot of bigger animals, a lot of birds. Snakes eat them. They're basically out there eating the little ants and grubs and things, and forming a really important food source for everybody else. So they get down in the leaf litter. You'll just see them slipping through. They have very small scales, so they get through the leaf litter real easily. A lot of folks think they're salamanders because they're so smooth. But they have, eyes and eyelids and ear openings like lizards and skinks, just very small. The five-line skink is called that basically because it's a juvenile. They have five stripes. So this is a juvenile. Juveniles have blue tails. Sometimes you'll hear people around here call them blue-tailed skinks. But they lose that when they get to be an adult. So this is an adult female. And the stripes are really declining on the adults. Females, you can still see them. Males, they're almost entirely gone. Males during breeding season will have a red throat and the stripes are gone. The females will lay eggs and they will coil around them and protect them from insects and things that might damage them. So they don't stay with them after they hatch like this. Once they hatch, the babies pretty well take off. But while they're eggs, they do stay around and protect them. The only teen we have in East Texas is the six-line racer, This one has six stripes instead of five, but it also has larger scales, big square scales that kind of fit together, make it pretty obvious. It's not a five-line skink. It's much faster tends to be out of the sandier, open, more open habitat than the skinks are. Skinks like to sit like a leaf litter. These guys really like to be hot, so we tend to see them later in the summer. We're not going to likely run across them unless we get a really hot day and we're in some sandy area. So around playgrounds and places where there's sandy soil in the middle of summer, you might accidentally see one. They've kind of declined in numbers too. Western slender glass lizard, Opossaurus, has never been real common in East Texas. Every once in a while we'll run across one. These guys don't have legs, so that makes them pretty easy to identify. But they do have ear, a hole for the ear, and they have eyelids. And they're a lot stiffer than a snake when you hold one. If you go to South Texas, down, say, in the Padre Island, places like that, they're pretty abundant down there. You don't run across them, but they just never, I don't know why, they've just never been very abundant in the island. Attenuatus refers to the long tail in these things. Like other lizards, the tail can break off. Lizards have the ability to drop the tail, and the tail will keep wiggling and keep the predator occupied while the actual body of the animal crawls away. That's called tail autotomy. Snakes can't do it, but lizards have these fusion, these plates in their vertebra. So it's not between vertebra, but it's actually the vertebra itself that breaks. The tail grows back, but it takes some time, and it's oftentimes not as long as the original. So it's kind of, you know, they don't want to drop them unless they have to. But if they're going to get eaten, you know, best to lose your tail and grow a new one. All right, snakes. Sorry it's taken so long, but yeah, a lot to get through. The colubrids are the harmless snakes, although there are some that actually have rear fangs.
Non-venomous snakes?
But they're non-venomous, yeah. Well, again, the rear fangs are venomous. So there are some, we just call them the harmless snakes, because generally they won't kill you. Okay? In general. There are a few that have killed people. Yellow-bellied water snakes, Neroidea erythrogaster. It's a dark gray snake with a yellow belly. Juveniles have some blotches instead of a plain gray, but I'm not going to probably put out any juveniles just because it's hard to know. We'll see juveniles when we go out and kill.
Is there one we caught when we went out to the next plane?
This
the broadback water snake?
Oh, yeah. When we were at the camp out? Yeah. Broadband water snake, Neroidea fasciata, is a really colorful one. It's got a lot of red on it and yellows. It's black. It's more of a fit the. These guys like larger swampy areas. These tend to be more of a creek, or they'll be in the swampy stuff, but they really like creeks a little more. The diamondback water snake tends to be a big water species. We have them here in the ponds on campus. We've actually had a few yellow bellies, but really the one that's most common on campus here is Rumble, the diamondback water snake. They get really large. They get 5 or so feet long, and they're very large and bulky. And people think they're poisonous. They'll actually flatten their head out and act bad, and they will bite. It hurts, but they're not poisonous. But everybody thinks with the triangular head identified as a poisonous snake. In fact, there was a news program about a week ago, and it was talking about all the all the flooding's caused all the snakes to come out, and you need to be careful and watch. And so they interviewed some guy who ran an alligator farm over in Van, and he proceeded to tell everybody that poisonous snakes have triangular heads. That's how you tell them. This diamondback has definitely got a triangular head, and he's not. So you want to watch your news programs. A lot of other snakes. These guys are all small, and they'll be a little tricky to tell apart. They'll be little, narrow, brown snakes of about 6-8 inches in length. Texas brown has dark patches behind the head, and then it's got these lines, these two lines of dots down its back. Reverse snakes are a real common one in East Texas. Actually, that one is too. But it's plain colored. There's actually two species of these, but this is the only one that's real common, the reverse snake. The flat-headed snake is only found in rocky habitat. And if you've got a rocky hillside and you flip the rocks, these guys are really abundant. They have a pink belly when they're live and a flat head, but the pink disappears, so you kind of got to look for that flat head. Can't tell it yourself. But it doesn't get as big as the reverse snake does. But those two will be hard to tell apart. These guys won't be too difficult. The ribbon snake is striped. It's the only striped snake we have. Amnophis proximus. They eat frogs and tadpoles, things like that. So you find them around the water. We should see those when we go out on field trip. Eastern coach whip is more of a dry adapted species. Tends to eat a lot of grasshoppers, but will also eat mammals if it can catch them, other snakes. It's pretty much a generalist in its diet. Tend to be black around here. If you go farther west, they'll tend to have some brown on the tail. But the eastern yellow-bellied racer looks a lot like it in the lab. They're both going to have smooth scales. One of the ways we initially identify snakes, be sure to look to see if the scales are smooth or if they have a keel down. The ribbon snake there, for example, and those water snakes, they have a little keel down each individual scale. These guys are smooth. The only way you can really tell them apart in the lab is to count the number of scale rows around the body. And I'm not sure I'm going to give you the numbers because I might get it wrong. One of them has 13 scale rows, the other one has 15 and 17. Probably did some genetics on them. It said they're very closely related.
Did you see the water snakes have the keel?
They have the keel. Uh-huh. Yeah. As you're going through your book, you'll read the key characteristics. They'll tell you in your book how to identify them.
Well, the lead racer has the keel.
No, they're smooth.
Both
smooth. So they're hard to tell apart.
Which one has the keel?
Oh, the ribbon snake. And I'm not sure the function of it, but the thamnophis, the ones that are in that subfamily all have keels. If you see a name like a rough something, then that typically means it has a keel. So the rough green snake has a keel. The rough earth snake has keels. you see smoother today, then it's not gonna happen. So, at any rate, these guys have feel in their scales. Ophiodorus decimus is, as you might think, an insect eater. They're very well camouflaged. They're all around in trees eating caterpillars. They'll eat some spiders. Definitely eating birds. We don't see them very often, but occasionally the pregnant females will be down on the ground where you can run into them. Western mud snakes are only in the swampy areas. Very smooth scales. They do hang around in muddy areas. They're bright red underneath, and they'll coil the tail up when they're disturbed and show the red. And the tip of the tail has a little spike on it, like a very sharp, short and spiky. And a live mud snake will wrap around your hand and it'll poke you with the tail. It doesn't hurt or anything, but it can be a little disconcerting if you're not used to that. And it probably was the source of the hoop snake legend. You know about, did you ever hear of hoop snakes when you were a kid? Yeah. When Disney used to have cartoons and stuff and show legends and stories, one of them was about the hoop snake. But anyway, the hoop snake is supposed to bite its own tail, and then it rolls down the hill, and then it'll straighten out and stab its tail into a tree and kill it. Kill the tree with venom in its tail. So probably got from this species. But anyway, they're really neat. They eat sirens, of all things. And maybe larval amphibians too. But at any rate, pretty unusual animals. And we might run across one. They're not absolutely completely rare. All right, these guys are all smooth scale too. These are the king snakes. I have to tell this whole brook eye is a speckled king snake. It's pretty easy to identify. It's dark color, black, with a spot at each scale. The prairie king snake is Lampropeltis alligaster. It has big blotches, dark blotches on it. You might mistake it for one of the rat snakes, but it has the smooth scales, okay? So it helps you identify it. Louisiana milk snakes are much smaller, and they are a coral snake mimic. But notice that the red and black touch. Red and black touches, that means it's venom black, right? Red to black, venom black. And that old rhyme.
Red on black, friend of Jack.
Or
red
friend
on yellow,
well,
telephone.
It's also friend of Jill, too, so gotta change that. These guys are called king snakes because they are known to eat other snakes, although prairie king snakes tend to eat more rodents than anything else.
So that one, the prairie king snake, it's what now? You said that one looks like something else.
It looks like some of the rat snakes. I'll show you.
Oh, okay. Looks like
so when you're in the lab here, when you look at this one, you'll see some rat snakes that look like it. Be aware this has smooth scales, so be sure to look at the scales. And I'll help you with that today. This is the one I'm talking about right here. It's pretty easy. Take this one. Well, actually, this is another rat snake. I encouraged Tyler, but I didn't put it out. But these guys have peels in them. Western rat snake. This one's pretty common. We have them here on campus. I get phone calls where they show up in the building. Because they're kind of aggressive. They don't bite a lot, but they'll strike and try to scare you. And they do scare the janitors. As the name implies, they will eat rats, but they eat a lot of birds. They actually climb up. Part of the reason they've survived on campus is they'll hide up in the trees. And so they have managed to survive at least up to this point. Hognose, I've got those on these on campus too, not anytime recently, but over in the nature preserve I've got them before. Hognose are toad specials. The only thing they'll eat are toads. And so they have enlarged rear fangs, and they actually puncture the toads. So, you know, toads will try to inflate when you bother them. And they can actually puncture with that, and they actually have a toxin in them that will immobilize the toad. They don't bite people, though. They'll try to scare you, and they'll flatten out like a cobra, and puff and hiss and make a lot of noise, and strike at you, but they keep their mouth closed. They won't bite. And then, if you keep bothering them, they realize, you know, they got to try something else, and then they play dead. Except they're not very smart about it. If you flip them right side up, they'll immediately flip back over. So, and they'll hang their tongue out and act really good. So they're kind of fun to catch because they're so unusual. All right, the poisonous snakes. Not too many in East Texas. We have pit vipers that have hemotoxic venom. That is, it works on the